Thanks for having me come up with this, this presentation is based on a class that I teach at UW in Milwaukee, in their water certification class that, that we have for continuing education program there. I've also given this presentation to several architectural firms, the Audubon Society, but I like to tweak it every time, you know, I give this presentation, sort of make it interesting for the audience that I'm going to be speaking to. And in this case, as you'll see later, I'm going to be doing a case study on the subdivision planning, master planning project that we did for the Stockbridge Muncie community. It was a very interesting project, so just wanted to give a little highlight on that. Tom Mortensen, I'm a registered landscape architect with RAC International. I've worked with a whole bunch of civil engineers, and I run a site planning and landscape architectural studio within a civil engineering firm. Whenever I say I'm a landscape architect, people always, at least in the Midwest, ask me what I do in winter. I know it's a landscape architect, not a landscape architect, so we get involved in a lot of land planning, a lot of public spaces, a lot of design that pertain to site, stormwater, and a lot of other things that kind of dovetail a lot with civil engineering. So the presentation, what I'm going to give is really focused on water. I mean, you know, we're talking about landscape, we're talking about site and stormwater, but I came up with this tagline just to create an awareness that, you know, the earth is not green, it's blue. I think we've heard a lot about green and sustainable and a lot of those types of developments over the years, but really creating an awareness of water, how we use it, why we use it, how much we use it, how we waste it, what a lot of this presentation is going to be about. So nature ignores design, that ignores nature. It's another thing that I use when I'm talking about site design. The photo on the left is probably about as far away from any natural process that you could imagine. But yet, that's a highly engineered system, and people went to college to learn how to do that. But if you look at it aesthetically and functionally, is that really the best we can do? Yes, it works. Yes, it was permitted. Yes, it meets all the laws for stormwater management. But is that what we, is that really the best that we can do with stormwater and aesthetics and foresight and design that parking lot mature that we're writing to members before we come on? So like I said, I work with a lot of civil engineers, and they're pretty intense guys. I'm really lucky. They're very, very talented people. I learn a lot from them, but they're highly technical people, and they always want to manage something. They want to calculate it. They want to be very, very technical about how they approach things. You know, the word stormwater, the term stormwater management is a very intense thing to say that we can manage what nature brings us. And we've done it, and we've tried it, and a lot of times we failed at it. We can't always manage it, and not every rainfall is a storm. So when you think about it, like I do, I think about it as rainfall integration. Yes, we do have floods. Yes, we do have big rain events. Yes, we do have to kind of manage what happens with the stuff that falls from the sky on our site. But if you think about it as rainfall integration, it gives you just a completely different perspective on what we do with this resource that's free that falls from the sky, rather than trying to manage it. Continue to waste it, pollute it, divert it, pump it, bottle it. And we always want to try to fix our water problems with highly engineered systems to meet the needs of the users. So what's happening now down in the south eastern part of the state, they want to pump the big machine water up to Waukesha because Waukesha has a major water problem. Once again, they want to fix it because they can. They can mathematically and functionally fix it. We have to ask the question, is that really a long-term solution? Is that really a viable long-term option for getting water to people in Waukesha County? Take a guess, how many bottles of water do you think it takes in volume to make one bottle of water? Just throw a number out, anyway.
16.
That's kind of where I thought it would be. But I did some research, and I found that a guy who had done some calculations used to work in the bottling of water industry. 88 bottles of water it takes to make one bottle of water. Even if it's half of that, I don't know how scientific the guy's study was, but even if it's half of that, it's still alarming. When you think about the ink, the caps, the labels, the plastic bottles, the cardboard containers that they come in, the shrink wrap, have, everything that goes into making one bottle of water is in volume 88 times that. And I'm not against bottled water because I think a lot of people need it. There are a lot of people who survive on bottled water because they don't have safe drinking water where they live. But when you're in the Great Lakes Basin or you do have access to fresh water, you have the question, you know, is that really a sustainable way to control water? In the U.S., we use more water in one day than we use oil in a year. When I found that out, I was pretty shocked. In Wisconsin, a lot of our withdrawal volume is from surface water. A lot of it is used for power generation. And quite a bit of it is used for irrigating agriculture, especially down in the central sands part of the state. Adams County, I know that region very, very well. I've kind of grown up in that area. You know, it's all pure sand. So in order to get crops to grow in sand, they got to irrigate it. And these high capacity well permits that are coming out in order to grow crops in sand, you know, you have to ask yourself, is that really a great way to crops and think about how we're using our drinking water. And the drinking water that from the state is some of the best drinking water. I can attest to that. So I have my well tested all the time. It's incredible. Well, but we're drawing it down for other purposes. So a couple more observations. The Aral Sea, this is in Kazakhstan. In 1964, the Aral was born. This was a large body of fresh water that was inland. Very valuable resource to the people that lived there. And they decided in 1964 that they wanted to create a hot zone, similar to what we have here in the U.S. They wanted to really boost their cotton industry. I don't know about you, but I don't know any Levi's jeans ever made in Kazakhstan, but that thing completely failed. But they depleted this entire body of water down to 2002. This is what the shoreline looks like after that many years. So that seems pretty shocking. Now, when you think about the Colorado River and Lake Mead, it's really not that strange because we're doing it here. We are depleting Lake Mead. The dam will not last forever. It's a highly engineered structure, and at some point it's going to fail. And I don't know that you've really thought about that group. So, just recently, last month, Civil Engineering Magazine read an article. The challenge was sustained drought conditions for more than 10 years and forecasted. Solution that this article had in this magazine, new larger multi-million dollar infrastructure. That was their solution. Not change your behavior, not think about how we're using water, but let's just keep it coming, and we'll keep engineering ways to get it to you. So again, they tried to fix it. And so this thinking really hasn't changed much. We're still doing things the way that we've always done them because water is plentiful and water is cheap. I think that's going to change. I heard someone predict that within 10 years, you're going to start to see trucks and train rail cars carrying water to dry areas of the U.S., just like we've been building it now with coal and other resources, truck it around, ship it around. So we're saying that's probably going to start happening with water in some of these areas of the U.S. and frankly across the world are really going to start to see a decline in their pressure. And again, is that a solution? Trucking it around, it'll lie sometimes, it's an mandate. So let's get, that was the Aral Sea in Kazakhstan, and went to the Colorado River. Here we are, the little lower river in Long Lake, which is your Stevens Point. It is ranked number 4 in the most endangered rivers in the U.S., which is pretty shocking as well. It's happening here. And I think it's kind of ironic that it's right next to UW Stevens Point, the Natural Resource School, environmental school, but it's really, it's kind of a wake-up call. And I don't know a lot about this little Clover River. I don't know all the technical aspects behind it. I haven't really been following it, but when I came across this ranking, it really kind of jumped out at me that, this isn't a problem in Kazakhstan or out west where it's dry. It's really a problem everywhere, and it's not going to get any better anytime soon. These articles were just from this past year, intensive farming. Area. Wisconsin beach water, the second worst in the nation, reports say. So if you have a pool in your backyard and you graded your yard, that potential water slid, the rain fell, the sheet flow towards your pool. So if you filled up your pool with water with no chlorine in it, and then you have the sheet flow go across the area where you let your dog go out, and then you styrofoam thing, and you dump that in there, and you put some gray water in there, maybe some laundry detergent. Would you swim in that? I certainly would, but that's what we do to our Great Lakes every day. That's what we do to our drinking water every day. The U.S. Badger that goes across the lake to Manitowoc lifted 4 tons of foliage. It's dumped under the drip since the 1950s. The EPA is trying to shut it down, but they're dumping coal ash into the lake that we're drinking water. And there's a lot of big fights over that, a lot of opinions. And I've taken that period, I actually like that period. It's kind of a whole relic. It's a bit of history, but you know, when you consider what it's doing for drinking water, I think it's time to start, you know, changing our thinking and our attitude towards it. So even out west, sites are stripped or aspirated, compacted, manipulated, and then we all always blame flooding on too much rain. And we come back to the sites with a paintbrush. brush, put a tiny little bit of topsoil on it, and we expect things to grow and absorb, and everything's going to function well. That's really not how it works. You know, once you've done this to the subgrade, it could take many, many years for that subgrade to react to water the way that it used to. So, temporary integrated patterns of hydrology and landscape. Things are changing. You're seeing a lot of different design principles and the methodology being used on site design and site planning and civil engineering. We learned from history, water becomes a resource instead of a waste product. When you start to just plant that seed into a design team's head, that with water is not a waste product, it's amazing what can happen in collaboration when things all come together. So what we try to do is we try to slow it down. We don't try to pipe it as fast as possible and make it go away. We actually slow it down and try to get it on the site and use it as a resource on the site. There's a lot of different ways to do that. Where the subsoils allow, you can infiltrate water where it's practical. That's not going to happen down in F1 or Milwaukee because it's all highly compacted clay and very, very high pH soil. So when people say we want to do a bioinfiltration basin in F1, I'll just say no, it's going to be a clay bathtub. It's not going to work, so don't try it. You know, I know you want to do that, but it's really, really not going to work. Let's look at the subgrade. Let's learn from what the soil is telling us and how it's going to function. We can still do some cool stuff. We're just not going to be able to infiltrate the soil. Permeable pavers, the DNR has just recently, actually is going to be coming out with a technical standard that allows permeable pavers to be a measured design method for water quality, which is a huge step. Now, I believe in the pavers. I've seen them. I've seen them after they've been installed 15, 20 years. They perform very, very well. They're not high maintenance. You can snowplow them. They function. They're very, very durable, as opposed to like a permeable concrete asphalt, which in this climate, I think the jury is still out on that. I'm not sure how well that stuff is performing, because it tends to hold water after it gets soaked up, and then it pops up popcorn. So permeable pavers, though, Illinois, Wisconsin, even up in Canada, Montreal, has a lot of these through the streets. They perform really, really well. And it's just another way to slow down that rainfall. Instead of piping it, which is really expensive infrastructure, get it, infiltrate it, stop rain, if not, at least you're capturing it through a void below the pavement, and you're slowing it down before you release it into a sewer or into a stream or a lake or whatever your water's on your feet. So I think, you know, stay tuned to that. I think you're going to see a lot more of that. Plus the cost of asphalt, when you really think about this. It's pretty cheap to get a parking lot done in asphalt. It's the most economical way to do it. But then when you project that out over 10, 15, 20 years, when you think about the maintenance of asphalt, it cracks, you gotta seal it, you gotta restripe it, you gotta cut it out, you gotta redo it. So within 20 years of the life cycle, if that, in this climate, you're replacing your asphalt. So for landowners who own property for a long time, and I'm not talking about retailers, you know, or stores, or properties are going to flip time and time again. But if you have a municipality or this site here where you're going to own this property for a long time, investing in these permeable pavement systems the first time around will save you so much money down the road for maintenance costs on typical asphalt and concrete. So stay tuned, you're going to hear a lot more about that in the next few years. I always try to challenge the nature approach with the civil engineers that I work with. They like to do the quickest, easiest, cheapest way, but they're not always the best solution. So once again, we just have to kind of change our thinking and approach. You know, stormwater ponds and parking lot islands and all of those things can really contribute to a much more viable site. There are three types of system configurations with managing stormwater and bioinfiltration. There's full infiltration, partial infiltration, and then flow through. So there's no infiltration. That's what I was talking about before. When you can't get it into the soil, that's okay. You can still do some acid things, and you can still do some, you know, intermediate things to slow that stormwater down and clean it up. The types of geometry on these basins, on these systems, there's a basin, there's planters, there's swales. And the one thing that I want to point out here is to avoid single inflow. So you saw that picture before. We have a pipe and the water coming out of the pipe. That's a single discharge point. That velocity of that water is very, very strong. So we're trying to dissolve it, we're trying to spread it out, we're trying to dilute it and break up that velocity. Having lunch with Dan before, I was talking about green roofs. Great, I think they're great. I've done a couple of them. But I think our future, or a big starting to see this happen now here down in the southeast. There are a lot of people capturing the rainfall and using it for non-potable uses. There's more and more of that. We can't just keep using our very expensive drinking water to wash our cars in January and scrub it up. It's just not going to be viable to do that forever and ever. So now it's time to start changing that. The design approach, techniques that we use when we are designing sites, I look at the Wisconsin landscape, but I observe these natural patterns. Landscapes colonize, they evolve and overlap, they tend to be big and bold. They're not really busy, they're not really complicated, they're not really vague. So when you start to look at sites, or when I do, I look around and what was growing here before we were all here, what types of vegetation was growing here, what was the terrain like, what's the soil like. You take those indicators and you use them throughout the planning process, and you're going to be much more successful in the end. Another thing I see a lot, especially in urbanized environments down in Milwaukee and the southern part of the state and other larger city areas, they try to force native landscape to grow where it's not going to grow. And it's just really a lose-lose situation. The photo on the upper right, that's an urban neighborhood of principal neighbors in Milwaukee. The tall vegetation on each side of the road is between the back of the curb and the sidewalk and 7 foot tall. And it really wasn't growing in that part of the state historically, and it's just not a good use of native vegetation. The photo down at the bottom left, that's a parking lot island where they tried to promote infiltration. Once again, this is like that. There are no water grades, the soil wasn't right for it, and every piece of vegetation that they tried to get to grow in these things died because of the amount of salt and other things that were flowing into these things. So not a great design method, not a great approach, not a great last at the bottom right photo where you see the small little tree in the middle of that swale. That tree died within a year. Trees can have to grow at the bottom of the swales. But this was designed. This was designed and approved and reviewed, and everyone said yeah to it, and someone paid for it, and they just did the wrong thing. You don't put trees down at the bottom of the swale. It's how often you see that in nature. You don't see trees growing at the bottom of gullies or alluvial wash areas. That's not where they grow. They grow on side slopes or up. Some of the challenges and roadblocks using native vegetation and for rainfall integration, you know, the site always has to look good for low cost, no maintenance at all times. It's impossible. It has to be an investment, not only by the property owner, but by everyone on the design team that you want to make this successful. You have to actually invest some real time and effort into it. It doesn't have to be expensive, but it's not going to be cheap and easy. A lot of times, a general contractor that's building a project, they don't know anything about native landscape. The landscape contractor that's hired is not experienced in native landscape. The facilities manager who takes over the project is not engaged or aware. So there's a lot of real challenges to try to get this to work, but things are changing. People are becoming much more aware of how these things work. One of my, I won't spend a lot of time on this, but one of the biggest challenges I have with municipal codes that we have to, is I do work for all the U.S., so I'm constantly looking at different one time I was doing a project in Reno, Nevada, and I went to the site, and it was a retail project. And I went to the site, and it was high here in the desert, so what was growing up there? Just basically some grasses, but mainly cedar trees, and that type of thing. Real brush-like, kind of a high alpine type of landscape. Well, their municipal code, if you read it, would have created a situation in which, based on the mathematical numbers that they came up with their code, square footage of asphalt, we would have had to plant over 1,000 trees for trees don't grow. So again, these municipal codes aren't even up to snuff when it comes to implementing some of the native landscape procedures and methods and design methodology. They have to change too, and I think municipalities and agencies are kind of leading the way in that, but it's kind of slow to come. but before I even know my title as site planner, but really a true site planner is everyone. It's a hydrologist, it's an ecologist, it's a landscape architect, civil engineers, and mainly it's the client, it's the people who are going to be using the site, all working together. You can't just do it as one person, you gotta be integrated and work together to support. So this project, when we were involved last year, the infrastructure was already in, so they already had sewer water, they had gravel roads were already in place, electrical was stuck to these areas, and I'll show you a site plan for that. And then they brought us in to kind of look at this in a different way, because in order to get this to really work, they would have to do a lot of site manipulation, a lot of grading, a lot of importing topsoil, a lot of infrastructure changes in order to get, you know, what they really wanted. So we had some public input sessions, and I think there's three or four of them that we conducted before we even did any design. It was not time to design it, so you actually find out what people want. And as we walk the site, what is this land telling us? What does it want to do? What doesn't it want to do? You can predict a little, but I think if we just really look at it differently, I think we'll come up with a better plan. They adopted that and raised it, so it's really hard to see here, but the block up to the top, north of the highway, that's Corner subdivision, and then the other area down to the south is one top. The existing roadways in, as I mentioned, you kind of see the model terrain. And that's what we started with. That was our base map to begin planning this residential neighborhood. So we started looking at the wooded areas. We mapped those out. You know, they wanted to try to keep as many of the trees as well, hard to ensure the maple. High quality trees. We map those out first. Then we put in the wetland areas. You can see on the top left there, a lot of wetland, a lot of high groundwater. So that is a design challenge when you're putting basements in your houses. Now you have to start to understand what the water tables do. And again, you didn't want to come in here and import millions of cubic yards of soil in order to build a house. You really wanted to kind of work with what was in the state and come up with. So we mapped the wetlands, got those on there. And we also identified steep slopes. Those are in purple. So you start to see how this terrain really starts to eat up some of this open space and really drives the design. Very, very interesting to do it like this, though, is when you start to overlap these natural patterns and you start to understand the hydrology, it starts to tell us what we should and shouldn't do. And if we fight it and we manipulate it, it's going to come back later as a higher expense or a failed system, or there's going to be some kind of a reaction to the action that you take. We also identified drainage patterns. So these are all existing drainage patterns. There's a lot of cattle in there where, you know, the water would just collect and there were ephemeral ponds, so in the spring they were wet and then they would dry out throughout the summer. But still, we have to respect those and work around those because that's part of the overall drainage system of this development. We also put in the setbacks, and I apologize if this is so hard to read, but setbacks were the distance off the edge of the pavement back onto the site. That was written as part of their comprehensive plan, so they established a setback. That means that no buildings can go any closer to the road than what these setbacks. So again, that's another site constraint in addition to all the natural things. Connectivity, we have two subdivisions bisected by a county highway. Not that busy of a highway, but busy. I mean, I don't think I'd want my 6-year-old kid crossing it. So we have to start thinking about how we align these roadways to make a safe intersection to connect these two communities so that they feel like one. Even though they are separate subdivisions, it's still a community. So we talked about how the road patterns might change. You can kind of see on that bottom one, you know, there's an existing cul-de-sac there, and there are tribal offices that are to the left of that. We're proposing actually one of the roadways so that we can line up an intersection, a safe intersection with good visibility, so that they can have connectivity between the animals. Sanitary was a big thing. You know, there's a lot of different ways that you can handle sanitary, but we analyzed the existing sewer system, the depth that was there, and the road patterns that were established. And we started to identify where you could place the structure, a building, a home, a multi-family, and still have gravity flow to the sanitary sewer. Because once you get away from gravity, let's look at what we have. What we have is that we can use this. Maybe you can see the red dots. Now, those are all water taps. So each one of these blocks, before we had all, this was all done before we had all, had water brought to each one of those blocks. But some of these blocks were unbuildable. And they're just gaping, plunging holes that you have to fill so much soil to never build above that just, it wasn't practical. So then we started to look at gravity flow using sanitary equipment and insulated pipes. So we put insulation on the pipe now in the main area, it starts to grow, and now we have a little bit more room to place some of these structures and some of these dwellings. And then we had some setbacks to that, and that adds a whole other complexity on where you place buildings. So in the end, what we ended up with, this is a component out of north. We have, let's see if this pointer works.
Red button.
Yeah. Okay. Oh, there it is. Okay. So here we have a neighborhood park. That was one of the elements of the public input sessions that they wanted to have. It's a small neighborhood park, park shelter, police structure, open space, this for kids to go and families to gather. We have different types of dwelling units. We have some multi-family kind of condos. We have typical single-family homes. We have mobile homes. This is the park area. So we kind of place those. And these, again, are all placed based on what we could get away with without having to manipulate the site in a tremendous way and incur a lot of cost. You can also see this dash line. Well, drinking water well was placed up on this hill, which is we had a wellhead protection zone that we also had to respect. Because if people are going to be working on their cars or using chemicals or doing anything like that, that could not occur within that wellhead protection zone. That was part of their initial design plan. So that was another site design. We also had, like I mentioned before, we had those sites that just kind of plunged down. Well, the bottom corner here, it's a south-facing slope. There is water already there, but it was really an unbuildable site. So they said, no, what we'd really like to do is come up with some community gardens. So we developed this concept where we had some terrace gardens, orchards, surrounded by, our kind of wildlife, but just a community area where people could go. And it's kind of a microclimate because it's down in a hole, it's facing south, it's nice and warm. And it really was a good use of that site because the slope and the terrain really worked perfectly and to employ a system like that. And then the Quantuck neighborhood, we left the roadway patterns as they were, and then we isolated some multi-family because that was another thing that they wanted to have, is at least three multi-family buildings from this. They identified that they needed that community, that there was need for it. So where is the best place for it? And the reason we came up with this site because it's close to a park and it had very good sanitary gravity flow. And it was a part of the site that, for a single family residence, it would have been a real pipe in the yard. So we thought that this would be a good place for the multifamily. And then there's just a concept a park here and then a future, offices and building for the tribe. Actually, So moving forward and finishing up here, the word sustainable, I think, this is just my opinion, I'm sure you agree with me, but I think it's just a little burned out. You know, it's kind of like, I mean, everyone's using this word sustainable, and if you really think about sustainable, it's almost impossible to achieve. Nothing that humans do, even if you go to the greenest building on Earth, you're still not fully sustainable because it takes energy to get there. You're using resources. There's a lot of things that go into that. So rather than saying sustainable, I like to, you know, use terms like logically efficient or less non-sustainable or it has less impacts. But the word sustainable, I think, is being misused and overused. And I think, you know, you're going to start to see that changing too because it's, I call it kind of a fad. I think it's a great idea, but I just think you have to challenge yourself. Is it really sustainable? You know, I'm very familiar with the LEED, supporting credits and the rating system, but I think it's misled, especially on the site component. LEED is very good for buildings, energy modeling, materials, that type of thing. But when it comes to the site, it really kind of fell flat. I think there's only 50% of the credits that you can get on a platinum project that are related to site. And I think that's kind of where it fell from. So this was one of their things for a water efficiency credit. Use of native or adaptive plants to reduce or eliminate irrigation requirements. Maybe it's not wise, just LEED. The drought tolerance does not mean plants don't need water. And in Wisconsin, we get 37 inches of rainfall a year, so our native plants need water. So on a lot of these designs and a lot of these projects, we do just keep irrigating them, at least for the first couple of years, to get them established. Because you can get them. But what this has done, what this statement has done, is it's made people think they don't know anything about site or landscape or native landscape. They walk around with bags of seed, you throw it down, and they walk away. And you're sustainable. And that is so far from the truth. So, you know, moving forward, I think we have to really understand much more about, that native, you know, the Midwest region doesn't mean they're all colony. You know, a lot of my non-native plants in my area thrive in the Midwest. So it's just kind of a misleading thing. Talking about water and how we manage small water and really the site. Our native landscape in the Midwest region does need water. So, things are changing. It'll happen region by region, site by site, project by project. The city of Port Warren, if you add 500 square feet of impervious surface to any project, you have to manage that small water on site. That's pretty strict. I don't know if they really get away with that here, but very, very strict. The city of Port Warren adopted it. What they think is that every little bit counts because it's all going to add up in the end. You'll probably see other cities kind of taking that. Well, Calgary, that's the California Building Code, basically they adopted the checklist for buildings. So that's the upside of the United States. We've done a great job of making us all aware of building and energy and resources. A couple of really good books concentrated on the food revolution is that. Starts off in Wisconsin, the author, she's from Florida, but it's a really good book. It's not a gloom and doom, we're all gonna die book. It's a really good view of how we have gotten to where we are now with our water situation. And she starts the book out by talking about how we hold the land that lived and his place in the central Sierra region. And how 20 minutes down the road is Wisconsin Dells. Probably the highest use of our drinking water for recreation. And it's just kind of an interesting going to get more and more complex, and there's going to be more and more pressure. Someone has predicted that within 50 years we're going to have wars over the Great Lakes. I don't know, I'm fatalist that way, but think about that. You know, where we have this great resource and other people are going to want it. The water commissioner in Las Vegas actually came up, is still promoting this idea of pumping water from the Mississippi flood water basin, but over the Rockies into Las Vegas. That's insane. But she's on a mission to get that done, but this is an economic thing. It's all about the money. So I don't really have a good answer for you, but the one thing I can tell you from experience is having someone like Luke or having a hydrologist, someone who really understands water and water law, getting that out in front and having that more as a preemptive, because it's going to get more, you're going to get more and more pressure from this type of resource. And the more you can have in place up front, I think is. Live without oil, live without iron, live without coal. We can't live without water. And I don't know that at all, but you know,
it's up to that. Is this by a big ice cube?
Sure. Or pumping from somewhere else, you know, maybe just an area where it was a way out. That's all I think. Do you have a question?
Yeah, you've heard of all neighbors that have a solution for people.
Well, they've done, and the reason the DNR is coming out with the technical standards is because they've spent years with monitor wells and suffering of these systems. So even if you're not getting infiltration, let's say your soils are really tight, but you're creating a gravel void and a series of pipes to create. So when those pollutants go in there, because there's a lot of nasty stuff that comes up there. That's why that parking lot out there showed you vegetation just can't grow in there. I mean, it's just impossible. Maybe some weeds, but that would be about it. So they've been measuring the monitor wells and water quality, and a lot of these solids, a lot of these pollutants actually bind up with the gravel that's been separated. And when you're putting in a perfect old paper parking lot, you know, you start with the big stuff at the bottom, and you predate your way up the smaller stuff, but it's all still loose, there are no lines, and it doesn't compact. So they're compacted, then they hold water, then they would pop. So the water moves pretty through this, but it acts as a filter. So they've been really staying on top of that. Now, that's a great question because I've wondered about stormwater ponds. You know, is that really our best solution? Someone was saying that the bottom, what's in the bottom of those ponds from these parking lots and all the pool and all this other stuff, and it's just whatever, put a toxic gag. And someone was saying that that's probably going to be the hot spot of the farm. So we come from all the fields and all these contaminated sites. What about our stormwater? Really haven't thought through what we're going to do with this stuff. We just right now we're kind of making it over there and kind of move on. But it's a great question, but they have been modeling the pollutants and the water quality coming out of this, which is why the DNR is going to adopt the standard. And it's a technical standard. You know, I've looked at it many times and I've talked to a lot of people about it who are using these monitoring wells, a lot of school engineering, a lot of universities have done studies on it. And